Hi, everybody.
Hello, Oz. How are you doing today?
I'm doing well, thank you. I need to change a couple of preferences. Something is messing up my voice settings, and I had to blow away my preferences to get it back. So now everything is messed up.
You need settings back up and restore.
Evidently.
Yay, that's
except,
just
of course, it. That it would back up and restore whatever the problem was.
You know, I haven't had that issue yet. It works fine on the Firestorm, but I've not had an issue with backing up whatever the problem is.
Yeah, all right. Well, whatever. I'll have to hunt that down at some point. I've been doing a lot of crazy things on my system. There's no telling what I've stepped on. Let's see. Where's my agenda page? There we go.
Small group today.
Well, we'll carefully not make any predictions about what that implies about how long the meeting will be. let's see. So, to do the usual rundown of the pipeline. So the layer limits viewer went out, and that is doing just fine in production. Perfectly reasonable crash rate. Well, as reasonable as viewer crash rates ever get. Other things that are coming. So we have put out an update to the attachments viewer, I believe. Let me double check my source of truth here. Yes, right. That's 3730, so that's new. There are updates of the other ones in progress, so we should have a big batch of maintenance fixes shortly coming out. Just, you know, random viewer fixes. All collected together. We should also have another version, another spin on the importer improvements project viewer pretty soon. And updates to the viewer managed marketplace viewer. And hopefully pretty soon the Oculus Rift viewer. So those are all still very much in progress. And experiences.
So ETA on viewer managed marketplace and experience tools.
So, experience tools is kind of a question mark. We're still, you know, that's not gated by the viewer. Although we've had a little bit of a change of responsibility internally that has slowed down getting getting viewer release merged to it, but we should get that sorted next week. So the ETA on that is still indeterminate, I'm afraid. I mean, we are making progress on the issues, the back-end issues that have been delaying that, but I'm long since given up taking guesses about how long that's going to take. But as far as I know, we still have not yet, and I'm pretty sure that this is still true, we have not yet uncovered a viewer-related problem with that. This is, so far, all the issues
Severin.
Are back in. To be a little bit more transparent, it's really scaling issues, right? So the experiences actually work just fine at the scale we're using them right now, which is to say hardly at all, relatively speaking. But what we're concerned about is what will happen when we turn them loose on on a much, much larger population, and there are lots more experiences running, and there are lots more simulators with experiences running on them. So what we've been doing is doing fairly intensive scaling and performance testing, and we're solving the problems that that testing has been uncovering. So we're making progress on it, and we're optimistic that the problems are definitely solvable, but we have run into a whole host of assorted issues with that. So that is making progress, and it's an area that I have been focusing pretty heavily on. The viewer managed marketplace, on the other hand, is going swimmingly. The beta period is going so smoothly that everybody's kind of amazed. So the merchants that have converted have generally found there to be the conversion to be very easy. The merchants who have been run through our automated conversion process have found that it just works and does the right thing. It doesn't work smoothly for... It doesn't work smooth. The automated conversion process is known not to work smoothly for people who have lots of items on the marketplace, lots of listings. And so the people we have chosen a threshold, I think it's 5,000. Don't quote me on that, but it's around there somewhere. And merchants with, and so the automated converter won't convert people who have listings over 5,000. It will just fail. It has some heuristics in it for pruning them down to under 5,000, like deleting the listings that haven't sold in the longest time, that kind of thing. That's not something we want to do without giving those people the opportunity to either convert manually, which they can do, or do the pruning themselves to get under 5,000 so that there will be no pruning, no automated pruning. So
you had
the merchants who have over 5,000 have been notified of this, and that they need to do something about it and how to do it, and we've got people ready to hold their hands and so forth.
I missed part of that conversation, so basically two questions. First of all, in your initial blog post about Viewer Managed Marketplace, you had said that, Linen Lab had said that there will be a 30-day transition period. Is that likely to still be a 30-day, or do you think you guys will probably extend that?
I don't recall exactly what that said, so I'm a little hesitant to provide an interpretation of it. Let me look at my notes here. They may be accelerating the timeline based on the fact that the testing to date in production has been going very, very smoothly. I mean, basically the back end is all in place, and so merchants can, if they switch to the project viewer, begin using this immediately. And all the reports from people who've been doing it are very, very good. I think there's like one more round of minor viewer bug fixes coming.
So the reason I ask is because we're on the sort of teeter-tottering right now on whether to get a release out quickly now or continue to wait for Viewer Managed Marketplace. And by now, I mean possibly go into feature freeze in 2 weeks and release 2 weeks after that, so a month from now. But if you guys are looking at you'll be releasing Viewer Managed Marketplace in, say, 2 or 3 weeks from now, then I'd be willing to postpone that until we can get our hands on that first, and that way our release will have Viewer Managed Marketplace as well. I just don't want to do a release and then have Viewer Managed Marketplace come out right afterwards, and have Linen Lab only offer users, you know, 30 days worth of transition time.
I don't want to comment on the 30 days number just because I don't know what event was supposed to start that clock. And I don't even know whether they've decided that 30 days is too much or too little.
If I remember correctly, I probably
unfortunately
don't.
Brooke
it was...
couldn't, right. Unfortunately, Brooke yeah. couldn't be here because she had a conflict. So
I think it was the magic boxes. You know, 30 days to get transition from magic boxes.
Get out of magic boxes, right? That's one thing that just to repeat something I know has been said before, but it should be very, very clear to everyone. The conversion process does not handle anything that's still in magic boxes. Those just won't be listed anymore. I mean, that if you let the automated conversion go, which will eventually happen. If you don't do anything else, the automated conversion will eventually run on your marketplace listing. Then your magic box items will just be gone. Well, I mean, the items will still be there sitting in the magic box, but there won't be anybody way to buy them anymore. So, and you'll have to manually recreate those listings from scratch. The listings corresponding to them will be gone. So, if you've still got things in magic boxes, you need to deal with that. And all the cases for which magic boxes were still needed under the direct delivery intermediate scheme that we were using are now no longer needed. There is no longer any need to have magic boxes anywhere. So you should get on the stick and do that, and you should do it now. But as to any 30-day clock, I can't comment on that because I just don't know.
And if you were in my position, what would you do? Would you wait for Viewer Managed Marketplace, or would you release?
I think it's given that. So I believe that the next step for the Viewer Managed Marketplace viewer is that we are going to do one more round of very minor bug fixes. That have come up. And I believe that the next iteration that we publish will either be a very short-lived project viewer that will then almost immediately turn into a release candidate, or it will be a release candidate. And of course, once it's a release candidate, it's perfectly legitimate for any of you to pull it and incorporate it into your release. So, you could start doing that merge now, and you wouldn't be far off.
We won't merge out of order. I'll tell you what I do.
The out of order thing introduces yet another degree of complexity, right? Because whether or not it becomes a release candidate, it might not become the default. Sorry, Jessica. It's not a good day for voice, I guess. Let's see if she gets that back, because otherwise I'll just have to repeat it anyway. Oh, right. Whether or not VMM becomes a release candidate quickly it may still not become the default release for, you know, some number of weeks after that, because there are other things competing with it. Looking at the queue,
no, it's Vivox keeps crashing on my computer. Yeah. Sorry, what did you say about merging out of order?
Well, even if we make it a release candidate, we can't make a firm prediction in advance about when it will become the default release, because that's something we just don't decide until it's time, right? It would probably end up being a pretty high priority. Offhand, it would either, the highest priority ones would either be experience tools or that. But if we don't think we've gotten enough experience with it, or it turns out that as a release candidate and it's getting thousands of users instead of dozens of users, actually, I don't know what the count on the project viewer is right now. I can look that up though.
I think I'm going to wait 2 weeks for the next third party viewer meeting, and we'll see where things look from there.
That reminds me, is the next third party viewer meeting in 2 weeks?
Isn't it?
As it happens, it is.
Okay.
Yes, June the 19th. Over the summer, they may be weird. It was 3 weeks since the last one, for example.
Yeah.
But yes, right. We're back on a 2 week rotation for a little while.
Okay, so that's what I'll do. And basically, based on what happens there, I'll decide then from there. Because I'm hoping within 2 weeks we'll have our RLV straightened out.
We will certainly know a good deal more by then.
Okay.
So that's I can offer you that much hope, however feeble that is. Let's see. Other things I had on the agenda. So that's it for what we know about upcoming viewer releases at this point.
Okay, I had a question. Is there more on the agenda? Sorry.
Well, I had two things I wanted to bring up.
Okay.
And Naran had put Unified Snapshot Floater on the list, which unfortunately I don't have very much to say about right at the moment, but I'll get to that. One thing that I wanted to talk about is ban lists. And I'm referring to ban lists for land here. Right now, there are no good... we certainly don't have a good user interface for managing the ban list. That is, for looking at it and figuring out who are the least important people on it that you can get rid of to make room for more, that sort of thing. I am putting out a general call for people to think about, and especially to contribute to implementing an improved ban list management mechanism.
Well, I'd start with putting a field in there where people can write notes about why they've banned a person, when they banned that person, details.
Right, right. And it may be pretty straightforward for us to do that kind of back end change in support of a front end change. Dates for when the ban occurred is another one.
I really think just adding a few fields on the back end that people can can write to. Firestorm and third party viewers had notes on people's profiles for a long time. And that's primarily what people use it for, is keeping notes on a particular person. It was a big deal.
And the profile notes went where?
Web profiles. Can you kill them?
No, I meant where did the data go when it did go somewhere?
Oh, you know what? I don't even remember.
That was actually originally from Linden Lab, the notes on a profile, was it not?
Wasn't
and
it?
And I believe it still supported server-side. Because I can get notes on people that I've done complete clean installs. So.
Oh, so there must still be a field.
So the note was something that you only saw the notes that you created.
Correct. Yeah, on other people. Nobody else could see that. So it's basically your little notes for some, like, I met this person, so-and-so, or whatever. There was a character limit, or is a character limit. It's very useful.
Uh-huh. Okay. Well, so here's what I'm really most interested in getting is somebody who's interested in doing the UI and front-end work in collaboration with us doing the back-end work for an improved ban list management interface. And so I'm sort of putting out a call for volunteers. And if you volunteer and want to put together a specific proposal, we will evaluate whether or not we can get that much work done in the back and how quickly and do all that good stuff. So that was what that agenda item was. So that's an opportunity to make all landowners think that you're a wonderful person. And of course, it comes with the usual, inclusion in the contributors list and all that good stuff that goes with that. The other thing, I just wanted to quickly go ahead and touch briefly on the group membership changes. Most of you will by now have noticed or heard one way or another that it's now... we're now explicitly not loading groups, not loading the full group membership list for very large groups. At the moment, the threshold is groups over 5,000. If you try to fetch the membership list, you just don't get an answer. That's a workaround for a problem that we've found that was impacting the chat system, among other things.
Is that related to the new premium perk of 60 groups?
No, actually, it's not. It was actually a completely independent thing. We briefly considered holding off on the bump to 60 groups for premium members because we were afraid that it might get pushed more groups over the limit, but. We looked at the numbers, and it was very unlikely that that.
So you say it's a workaround, because the thing is, I'm sure you realize this is going to be really, really. There's going to be a lot of people pissed off about this, and it's going to impact a lot of people. It's going to make people angry. It's going to be impactful on their experience and how they use the viewer, how they manage their groups.
Let me do a couple of things about that. People who can manage groups won't be affected at all, because if you have the privileges required to eject people or change their roles, then you're not affected. You still have the ability to get the whole group membership. Only people who don't have those privileges can't get
so. Them. The way a lot of groups will work, and not just support groups, but groups in general, is somebody will join the group. They'll need to get a hold of somebody who runs the group, and they go into the roles, and they see who the managers of that group are. That's the only way that people in the group can find out who is running it, This eliminates that capability.
Right. So I hear that requirement, and we will do something about that. We will find a way to make that information available in the fullness of time, but it probably won't be real quick. for very large groups. Mind you, there are only 600 and something groups this big in all of Second Life. And there
it's the big groups that need it the most, though.
Well, yeah, but the other thing to bear in mind is actually queries for large groups have not been working for a couple of years now. You may think they were because you were getting lots of people back, but you were almost never getting them all.
Oh, no, believe me, we know.
We've looked at that carefully. Right?
Yeah, we definitely know that.
We actually ran a test recently where we know what the right answer is, right? We can look at the database and know how many members it really needs to be. And so we ran a test, and it took 12 and a half minutes to get one of the larger groups' full membership loaded. And you have to just sit there and not do anything else in order for that 12 and a half minutes to actually finish. Okay? I mean, literally not do anything else.
And God help if somebody walks into your view while you're waiting.
Right.
Enters the region or anything.
Any number of things. Right. So in fact, while people may think that they've been getting the group membership list and able to see it, in fact, they have not been able to. Almost never for these very, very, very large groups. And we have some that are way over 5,000. We have some that are way over, you know, they're well up into the six digits. They're a problem, and we're gonna fix the problems, but it's gonna require building some new interfaces for doing things like show me who the officers are. They're among the two biggest ones. They're in the top five anyway. I forget the exact order. Yeah, we use Bloodlines for testing a lot on big group related issues because it's
sad that Bloodlines is so popular.
Well, you know, I think it's actually wonderful. There are obviously a lot of people enjoying it. That's a good thing.
The other question though, Oz, is if suddenly this just starts happening across the grid.
And it will.
Certainly, our support group is our support. There's going to be an impact on us, and we're going to kind of need to be able to point people at something.
Okay, on the question of how to put contact in, how to get contact information to people, you've got a group description. Use it.
Increase the character limit, maybe.
I'll think about that. I'll ask how difficult that is, but you know, that's the very short term immediate workaround for that particular problem, and it's the best I can suggest for you right now.
Is LinenLab going to have an announcement of any kind anywhere that we can direct users to?
I wasn't planning on it.
Because it's going to be a very big challenge for our support team because everybody's going to be, you know, for however many users we have, Firestorm is broken. Firestorm is broken. Firestorm is broken.
It's Friday afternoon now. We don't tend to put out posts that late anyway, and I haven't even if we were going to, I haven't even started writing it. So, not likely before next week, but I will talk to some people about whether or not we should do that next week when in time to synchronize it with when that release goes to.
Yeah, if you could have something for when that goes live on the main channel.
Right.
That would be hugely beneficial to us.
We would greatly appreciate it, and I might even personally owe you favors for it, Oz.
Okay. Well, that's worth a lot. We're going to be probably making some more changes. There are certainly going to be some bug fixes for the viewer coming quite quickly, probably in the next maintenance viewer, not the one that'll be out next week, but the next one that will clean up, you know, sort of how things look. You'll actually, you know, get a positive indication that, sorry, you can't see this list or whatever. We're still fiddling with that a little bit. There will be some other changes. There are other changes in progress that will want you to pick up as quickly as possible, just because there's a lot of time being wasted on requests that aren't going to succeed. It turns out, and this was one of the reasons we just made the change on the release channel, was because we weren't really sure what it would affect. It turns out there are a bunch of places in the viewer where the viewer triggers these requests for all the members of a group where it's not even going to use the data. And as I just explained, on these very large groups, it doesn't work anyway. So some of those requests are kind of bogus and not helpful. And we're going to be making a set of changes to take those out in our viewer and replace them with something more accurately focused. I'll be talking about those probably at our next get together. I'll try to have a set of pointers for people, and we'll try to get those out to people quickly. Yeah, you know, this was an RC region for a while, and then I should change that again. I moved it to Snack because I wanted it to be on that early RC channel, and then it didn't go back. It used to be in Magnum, I think. I'll have it moved back to one of the regular RCs, because I'd rather run my regions on the RC, so that when there's something wrong like this, you'll all have them right to hand and can complain about them in person. More to come on that. We will have new and improved ways of dealing with groups and probably end up introducing some new features in groups in the process, possibly resurrecting things like notes on things. In the meantime, it will stop having the bad impact on chat that it's been having, and various other stuff. So we'll get to that. It's going to be an area of focus for a while. It's probably not going to be quick, because anything that's this big, you have to kind of go slowly and carefully. We'll see how it goes. And I think that does completely burn up my agenda. Naran had posted a question about the unified snapshot floater. For anybody that hadn't already noticed it, there's a he filed a JIRA with a whole bunch of suggested changes, and we are most of the way through reviewing those. Most of them are really good, and we're fine with them. There were a couple more that were on the we still have to look more closely at this to figure out either whether it overlaps with something we were doing elsewhere, or whether it's something we really don't want. Is that the, thank you. That's the link. Thank you, Whirly, as usual. A lot of those we're going to be taking. You'll be seeing those in some future snowstorm build. The last few decisions we have to make are going to take a little time. Primarily because Grumpity is one of the people that has to be in on that decision, and she's gone off on maternity leave for a little while. So we will get to that when she gets back in a few weeks.
Congrats to Grumpity then.
Yes. She actually deferred some of her maternity leave. She used a little bit when the baby was born, and then saved some up.
Oh,
and
that's
using
awesome.
Some more now.
I didn't even know that.
Yeah. Yeah. We will get back to that, and we will be doing most of what's in there. if any of you, I mean, there's the link. If any of you think that there may be an issue that I should, that should be brought to our attention about any of those changes, by all means, you know how to reach me. But that, hopefully that will move along again soon by the time Grumpity gets back. And let's see. So that really is the last of the agenda. So improved bandwidth. What's the one that gets requested a lot?
Oz, you got a few things in local there.
Yeah, so I was just quickly scanning the one that got linked in chat here. Yeah, those are pretty good ideas. Let me put a marker on that one. Paige, I would really, really prefer an email. I hate to diss the communications mechanism of our own product, but I live my life out of my email inbox. So I'd be delighted to have some blog post wording, but okay. One of the banes of my existence is that I have way too many communications mechanisms. I'm trying to get a grip on that over time. Yeah. Wouldn't that be fun? I wonder if that domain exists. I bet it does.
Oh, you can be sure. I mean, isn't every domain owned by someone by now? Must be.
It's. I wanted to buy one just recently, and it was two words concatenated that I wanted, and I went out and looked for it, and sure enough, of course, it was registered, and because probably all combinations of two words are. The guy wanted $2,000 for it.
Oh my God. There are people who will pay it.
So I put a hyphen in the middle of the name and registered it for $9. Anyway, that's neither here nor there. Oh, I don't even count. I'm pretty good about keeping the inbox part small. I delete them pretty fast. I do occasionally use the, this has gotten old enough that I can archive it, and if they really care about it badly enough, they'll send me an email again rule mechanism.
My Outlook archives are 242 megabytes and goes back to 2006.
Yeah, I
delete email, nothing.
But the company prunes them at some age. I don't know what it is. Do Vivox have a fix lurking for that? Yes. They told me recently that they did. I have not yet seen a build. I have not yet gotten a build into RQA for it yet. But they're doing one for us. So yes, that's a really annoying bug, and we're trying to get it fixed. They were able to repro that the very first day that it was reported, and claimed to have a fix for it shortly thereafter. So, but it hasn't gotten into a build we can put in QA. Group notices as group notice transports. I'm not aware of any.
Okay, I'm asking us because sometimes I have notices for groups like ACES that are not coming through. It's kind of like with the way the chat servers were working there for a little while. I'm seeing that problem with group notices now.
Well, that was really nice for a little while. It's wonderful that it has gotten better enough that you're thinking of the problems as having only lasted for a little while. Because I kind of recall it was like years, but okay. I'll go with that.
I'm still having issues with it, Oz. No, not group chat. With group notices.
Group notices. Okay.
And they're not coming in as online and offline. I'm not getting those at all, period, in some cases. And I have to refresh the group to get them to start working again.
Well, I know we have a bunch of fixes for notices that are viewer-side fixes. Whether or not those will affect what you're seeing, the problem you're seeing, I don't know. I think that once we have those out, and those should come out pretty soon, there's a whole batch of those. Those should be coming out shortly. Then I think we should go back and maybe you could do some testing on that viewer, especially with that viewer as the receiver. I haven't actually reviewed the UI changes in that group, so I can't tell you what it was. Somebody else was sort of shepherding that. I should do that actually. But do some retesting on that, and if we can get some nice reproducible cases or even some very good logs of events that occurred or did not occur at specific times on specific regions so that we can go back and get the logs, then we'll try to do that and try to document exactly what the problem is. And we, you know, the trouble is that, you know, something like this notice didn't get delivered to everybody is first of all difficult to check, and second of all, almost certainly, you know, on symptoms like that, it's often the case that there are many bugs that either collaborate or you take turns causing the problem. And so we'll have to dig into it. But I believe that we've fixed a bunch of problems in the viewer side of that problem, and that will make it easier to detect and diagnose any remaining server problems, and then we can try to prioritize that appropriately. It would be nice if that worked better, obviously.
Oz, any news on Havoc for Mac and Linux 32?
On Havoc for I gave you those.
Did you to Nikki?
Yeah, I gave you the tools update builds for Havoc that we used.
Oh, I wasn't aware she had that.
Yeah, I think I did. Oh, but there were some problems with those. Right. No, that's right. That I apologize. You have a working one for Windows, and the symbol tables got messed up on the, it looks like the symbol tables got messed up.
See, I was just about to go and fire
Mac
Nikki.
And Linux version of the libraries. No, you're right. No, I haven't done anything about that, and I should. But I will try to get back to that. Hopefully, whatever fixes it for Mac will also fix it for Linux.
I mean, we're hoping we can get that for, obviously, the next release, right?
Yeah, but let's be serious. If you didn't have that feature in the Mac, it wouldn't be a tragedy. It's only a few percent of your users.
They are very loud few percenters.
No kidding.
And still, you know, 5% of 300,000 or four, whatever. That's
hey, listen,
a lot
I'm
of
a
people.
Mac user myself. I, you know, yeah. I suffer the pain of the Mac user.
No, you don't.
I do. Well, some of it anyway. Some
you
of
you
them
don't seem
to
suffer
have
from the Mac bugs.
Have.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, you know, which.
There are no Mac bugs.
There, yeah. No, there are some. Just another little thing along a similar line. We are making lots of headway on the updating the web media plugin to be using Chrome Embedded Framework. We may even have a project viewer pretty soon. When we do. It's going to be one of the first. It's going to end up being one of the first things that we're going to be relying on the third-party viewer community to do the Linux support for. So, if there isn't someone stepping up from the Linux community to do that work for Linux, it's liable not to get done, and that'll be the end of it.
There's been a lot of viewer developers discouraged with the platform thing not being open source and whatnot. And so getting open source devs motivated now is really difficult.
You know that I'm not going to comment on any decision or any characteristic of Project Sansar. I'm just not.
That was worth a try.
I spend a really inordinate amount of time worrying a lot and thinking a lot and working hard a lot on making Second Life better, and I just don't have time to worry about anything else. I don't even go to most of their demos.
I'll gladly take your place.
I'm told their demos are really cool, and the couple I've seen are amazing. But mostly, I
skip. In what way?
Just amazing. And in fairness, I don't think they could do what they're doing if they were limiting themselves to all open source available components for the client. I don't think it would be possible. So, that's pretty much all I can say about that. Yeah. But Second Life is open source, and there you go.
It's convincing people that Second Life is going to be still around is the problem.
Yeah, that's the problem.
Well, I'm convinced.
Yeah, but you don't see bugs with Mac either.
I'm relatively convinced that Second Life isn't going anyplace either, but that's, you know, I'm known to be crazy. I've been doing support for 5 years, so.
Yeah, so I'm satisfied that my my position has plenty of longevity. And I'm real happy about that. So, any other topics besides Project Sansar, which at least now I can use the name for, but that's pretty much all I'll give you about it.
I've got nothing else. I'll just try to get Brooke here if you can for next third party view meeting.
I will. She had a conflict today, but I'm sure she'll try to make it. She's been pretty good about it.
Oh, come on, people. We've got Jessica Lyon here, and we're going to give Oz 5 minutes back? No, come on.
Hey, it's Friday afternoon. You can let me off early any time. It's a glorious day out there.
Yeah, I know.
Even though the 3 days of ridiculously cold rain have cooled my pond down unreasonably, I may still go swimming.
I've had over a month of rain, so 3 days. Wow. you can don't complain about the 3 days with me.
There are a bunch of people in California that would like to borrow some of your rain.
Yeah, I know y'all would. We had about 40 inches of rain here where I live in the last month.
Ryder, I'll send you all the rain I can if you'll send me some of that extra heat that you have.
Let's see.
I don't want the heat. I don't want the heat, and you can keep the heat. I want some cold.
When prefs are opened, is a chewy bug that happens. Oh, okay. I shouldn't have to bug people for fixes that are in the base code. You know, if you find something that's a bug in the base code, send it upstream. You'll save yourself the effort of urging it again. I'll take them. I'll use them.
I wasn't even aware that was repro'd on the Linden Viewer.
Well, maybe it isn't. Another set of fixes that are in progress now that I'm going to want you to merge quickly when they come out is... We found a lot of nonsense to do with calling cards, and we're
really
fixing them up.
They were bugs with calling cards
in your inventory.
Like the fact that they're actually wasn't it us that told you that?
Yeah,
that they
it was.
Duplicate. Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
So you're fixing that.
I understand that actually the duplicating was your bug, but. Anyway, it doesn't matter that we're fixing that, and we may put in an inventory transform to dedupe the calling cards. I believe you. One of the things that happens right now is that having a calling card triggers a presence lookup at login. And we've got people who have 50,000 calling cards.
Imagine if they have duplicates.
Well, most of those are duplicates, but the code is not so clever, so it sends multiple presence requests for the same person. In the next round of main fixes, so 2-3 weeks. What I have asked the engineer working on it to do is to change our code so that if someone is your friend, which is represented in the calling cards folder by them being in the friends subfolder, then if and only if they are your friend, will they be in the friends subfolder? Then those people get presence lookups. And if they are not your friend and you just have a calling card because either they used to be your friend and now they aren't anymore, or somebody just gave you a calling card, because you can transfer them like any other element of inventory. You can just drag them to each other. Then those cards, the cards for non-friends, will not trigger presence lookups. Mm. And that's the behavior I would like everybody to have. So a calling card then is just a calling card, right? So if I have you in my Rolodex, that doesn't mean whether I check that you're online, every time I wake up.
Oz, about calling cards, is there any plan to fix the hierarchy of the calling cards folder?
We're gonna try to take that on too, yes.
Yeah, because
whether or not that will be part of the same batch of fixes, I don't know. It may be that we're going to need to just do some work server side to go through and cause those to get cleaned up. But we're going to look at that.
Worlds asks, fixes for... because when you embed a calling card into a note card, you can get some weird issues as well.
I wasn't aware of that one, so I'm sure that Willie will send me an email with pointers to the specific jurors for that, and we'll try to get them incorporated into the same batch. Because it would be nice to sort of clean it. Calling cards, I think... This is just a guess on my part, but it's based on the fact that I've read a whole bunch of internal wiki pages about one project or another that had to do with calling cards. And there seem to have been at least three or four different perspectives from different developers and contributors within Second Life as to what it is a calling card represented or was supposed to do. And we've ended up with this sort of weird mishmash hybrid of those different perspectives, and we're going to try and kind of clean that up and get a proper conceptual
nine copy sets.
Nine.
It would That's be nice. It copies. Would be nice.
That's probably it a lot would more be than nice.
Would really be nice if we can actually delete some of those duplicates without removing the person from our friends list. But by military protocol, three is max. You should get no more than three calling cards.
Okay. The rule that I would like to be true is that you can have no more than one for anybody in the friends folder, because the friends folder should be special in that the only thing it is an inventory representation of...
Well, you must be some kind of six versions of special then. Because you've been friends six times.
Well, that's. I guess that's not a bad thing. I feel pretty good about that. So your friends folder should just represent who you have friend relationships with. And that should always match what the server thinks the friend relationships are, right? Because that friend relationship is represented in some database table somewhere, right? So that should always match. And when it changes, it should be fixed so that it always matches. And therefore, you should only have one for any given friend in your friend folder. Now, outside the friends folder, they're just inventory items, and you should be able to copy them and duplicate them however you want to. But I would like it to be true that there's a way for you to just say, please deduplicate my friends folder, which we can do right now by hand if people ask us to, but we're going to do it programmatically and set it up so that it's one of the things you can ask us for to do for you.
I'll close. I have to get going. I just want to close with kudos on the 60 group limit as a premium perk.
Yeah, that one went over pretty well, huh?
Yeah, honestly, can I criticize just a little bit? All the other perks were really not perks. They really weren't. Like fail blimp, fail train, fail boat, fair failed plane, Linden homes that are so laggy.
The GIFs and all that.
Yeah, the GIFs and all that. The 60 groups, that's a perk, and I plan to take advantage of it.
You know, people say that none of those are a big deal, but a lot of people went and got them.
Really? There's that many suckers out there? I mean, what a shame.
There are a lot of Linden homes out there for people, and I do see a lot of them being occupied.
Linden homes do, in fact, get used. They're quite popular. So,
Have they gotten better? I mean, because I tried them once.
Actually,
and
they did.
I ended up...
We recently rebuilt them, and they're a lot lighter weight on the world.
London home is a great dress these days.
Yeah, and on rendering, because when I went in there, I had a linen home for a little while, and I eventually called support and told them to get rid of it. Because even on the computer I had, which wasn't a bad computer, it just lagged me to no end. I just couldn't move. It was like soup.
They're much better than they were. The biggest problem with them is the control panel stopped working every couple days.
Huh.
Well, I don't know anything about that.
I have a quick question for you on for those of us that are already beta testing or were already beta testing the VMM viewer before y'all announced the 3-month free premium membership. Are we going to be credited for that as premium members?
I have no idea. I don't know anything about that offer. Not the sort of thing I would normally have anything to do with. But if you will send me that question in an email, I will figure out who the right person to forward it to is and get you an
Okay,
email.
I can do that, Oz. Thank you.
Yeah, I'm happy to try to redirect. I'm not sure who to redirect to, but somebody will know.
I'll give it to Brooke. She'll love you.
Yeah, I could try Brooke. I could try. There are a couple people I could try. But we get this reaction a lot that people will will do something either for premiums or for some other purpose and say and we get a lot of comments on forums and especially on SLU where people seem to think that that they can win a prize by being the first to criticize something or being the snarkiest criticism. I suppose all that has its place, but
That's SLU.
Yeah, but we get a lot of people who say this, that, or the other thing is really valueless and of no particular interest to anyone, except that we get to see the real stats. And there are lots of people who actually start using whatever it is, right? So it's not true that it doesn't have any value to anyone because a lot of people use it. So before we did the bump to 60 groups, we looked at, we looked at the real numbers for how many groups are people really in. And it's kind of an interesting curve. You have a lot of people who are in hardly any groups, and then you have a relatively shallow trough for the number of people who are in 20 groups or 30 groups. And then there was another peak at the end where we had a fair number of people, both premium and non-premium, who are in 35 or more groups, right? So they're up at the top, and that tells us that there's a good sized population who really were running into the limit. Yeah, that was one of the most more picks is one of the most common comments we got on that, which is interesting.
Just out of curiosity, Oz, would you say that over 15% of the user base has already got 42 groups filled?
I hate to use numbers in a comment if I don't have the stats in front of me, and I don't remember them well enough to do that. Purely offhand, I don't think it was that high. I don't think it was anywhere near that high.
Just curious.
But even a small percentage can be a pretty large absolute number. But we looked at who was up there and which users they were and which ones were premium and which ones weren't and all that. We did a pretty deep dive on the numbers on this and decided that it would be a really good thing. This has been one of our repeating themes this year. By now, you will have figured that out, is that we're trying to look at lots of the things that have limits and figuring out whether it makes sense to raise them or lower them or whatever, right? To is there something we should do about any given limit? And some of the things that we've looked at and we've said, yep, that limit exists for a really good and important reason, and if we change it, it will really make life bad for everyone, so we shouldn't. And some things we have looked at and said, you know what, we can afford to make this quite a bit higher, and we're going to keep doing that. We're going to keep looking for ways we can change the limits, and where it makes sense for a limit change to be something that's premium only, we will also ask the question of whether that should be a premium only change, because we are trying to make premium more valuable to people.
We actually want Second Life to remain profitable, right? So the more premium mechanics you can get, the more profitable Linden Lab is, Second Life is, the longer Second Life will keep going.
Well, whether it makes us more profitable or not, it definitely changes the revenue mix. And, you know, one of the things that people have said is that, you know, it's that our revenue mix is very lopsided. Land is way too big a percentage. And that's true, and everybody in Linden
all eggs in one basket.
It creates a distortion in our it makes it more difficult for us to make some kinds of changes, because we run the risk of having too big an impact,
right? Your premium membership is always going to be low for an actual revenue generator, or it's because you give most of it, the money back in the stipend.
We get it back as economic activity, right?
And that's a
good thing, and that's part of why we'd love to make premium more attractive to more people, because it's a really good deal. I mean, if you pay for it annually, you basically come out ahead or pretty close.
Well, with my stipend, mind you, I've been premium since forever, but with my stipend, I at the end of the year, I've basically paid about, I think, like $7 a year for my premium.
Yeah, it's if you do it annually, it's a and you work out what the value of it is, and you assume that you would be paying for all the things you get anyway. Then it's a really, really good deal.
Yeah, but this $100 Canadian dollars to buy a US dollar is killing me, Oz.
Yeah.
Right. The strength of the dollar is not a good thing for many kinds of American businesses, and we're one of them. Anyway, so are we good?
Yeah, I'm good. Good to go. Have a good weekend, people.
Other than Ryder, as soon as I get that thermos of hot air up here, I'll send you a bottle of rain.
Okay.
Hey, Ed, I'll send you some hot weather. Just send Ryder some rain.
Send what?
Thanks, Oz.
Send what?
Money? I'll send you some hot water. You send him some rain.
Oh, I'll send him weather. I don't need no hot water.
You can have all the hot water. Hot weather.
Yeah, I want the hot weather. All right, I'm out of here too. I'll talk to you later, Jeff. Probably on Skype, I'm assuming.
Yeah, grab me. Well, I'm gone all weekend. I've got a.
Yeah, I'll talk to you when you're. I'll talk to you when you're safely ensconced and tired.
Yeah, next week.
Take care, Jessica.
Okay.
Hope the weekend goes good.
Later, folks.
And Ed, you can have all the hot air that I have down here in Texas. Keep it.
Oh, I'd love it. I'd love it.
Keep it. I don't want it.
Other people that live here would hate me for it.